Hi, I'm Tara from the National Asthma Campaign. Welcome to the Everyday Asthma Program. Look, we understand that a 500-page treatment guideline document can be a little much. Luckily, the NAEPP assembled a special Asthma Guidelines Implementation Panel to help make the guidelines more manageable. This panel simplified the key messages in the larger report to make it practical for clinicians to implement the guidelines in the real world. This program highlights the six priority messages from the panel and how they fit into everyday practice. For this program, we assembled a spectacular faculty with great patient spotlights along the way. We also think it's pretty cool to get CME on YouTube. To get credit, check out the description below for a post-test link, and if you'd like, take a moment to subscribe to our channel. Thank you so much for participating, and we sincerely hope that you find this activity helpful.
The guidelines implementation plan was put together by a committee of 17 individuals, and the individuals range from lay people to asthma specialists, primary care, representatives from the government agencies, and educators. The implementation plan was based on the concept of messages, sort of like big marketing plan. The marketing plan in this case was marketing asthma through the national guidelines. Remember, the guidelines have been organized through something called an NAEPP. That was convened by the National Heart and Lung and Blood Institute for the National Institute of Health. And this committee was the one that directed the guideline development and the implementation plan. And in this implementation plan, there's a number of messages that you should be listening to and basing your intervention with your patients. The major message is inhaled corticosteroids are the major groups of pharmacologic agents that should be used not only to treat your patients, to prevent the patient from becoming worse.
This is Dr. Aidan Long. I'm the clinical director and the training program director in allergy and immunology at Massachusetts General Hospital. And I'm an associate professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School in Boston. And today we're going to be talking about the priority messages of the expert panel report number 3 in the diagnosis and management of asthma. The first priority message of the report is regarding the use of controller medications. The expert panel recommends that long-term control medications be taken on a long-term basis to achieve and maintain control of persistent asthma, and that inhaled corticosteroids are the most potent and consistently effective long-term control medication for asthma. If we think of some of the evidence supporting this recommendation, we might look at a study such as the one shown on this slide, taken from Suiza, who looked at a Canadian province with respect to use of inhaled corticosteroids and the risk of asthma deaths. And what was clearly shown that throughout that entire province of Manitoba, that during the year of study, the risk of dying from death, as shown on the vertical axis, reduced as the number of canisters of inhaled corticosteroid per year were used, showing an inverse correlation between the risk of dying and the number of canisters of inhaled corticosteroids, showing a very clear protective effect in terms of asthma mortality from inhaled corticosteroids. Similar data are also available from other countries, in particular Israel and Sweden, showing very similar results. Rather than looking at the risk of dying, this study addressed the risk of hospitalization as a function of inhaled corticosteroid use in asthma, and once again showed a similar inverse effect. This is a somewhat busy slide, but if you look at the horizontal axis, in particular the four sets of data at the bottom of the slide, these reflect the use of inhaled corticosteroids as number of prescriptions per year, and the different colors represent different age groups. If you look at the orange, which is the most bottom one, that is the total age groups, not differentiated. And what you can see is that at the left-hand side, when no inhaled corticosteroids were used, there was an increased risk of hospitalization from asthma. But as you got to more than one or two canisters per year, that risk dropped to zero and basically stayed there. This is in sharp contrast to the more brightly colored parts of the graph, which represent use of beta agonists, or not controller medications, but rescue medications. And you see there, as the number of those increased, the risk of hospitalization increased. This suggests that more beta agonist use is associated with poorer control of asthma and the need for hospitalization, whereas consistent use of inhaled corticosteroids abrogates that risk and keeps the risk of hospitalization low. So these two pieces of evidence very strongly support the first priority message of the expert panel report.
The treatment of asthma is now directed by the pathology. What happens in the bronchial tubes? What happens in the bronchial tubes with anybody with persistent asthma, which represents somewhere between 60 to 70% of individuals with asthma, have inflammation. Very simple. You have inflammation that's causing the disease, causing the impairment, the risk. The only pharmacologic agents to use is inhaled corticosteroids. 100% of my patients with persistent asthma are on inhaled corticosteroids.
Second priority message related to use of asthma action plans. The expert panel recommends that all patients who have asthma be provided with a written asthma action plan that includes instruction for daily treatment, including use of medications and environmental control, and education about how to recognize and handle worsening asthma. The evidence supporting this recommendation comes from several studies, and I have selected one of them here, which was an analysis of 26 randomized trials that incorporated the use of written asthma action plans and seeing whether they had a salutary outcome in terms of asthma outcomes. This was published in 2004 in the Cochrane Review Database, and it basically drew the following conclusions: that written asthma action plans that were based on use of personal best peak flow, the use of asthma action points, and recommendations for use of inhaled corticosteroids and oral corticosteroids for exacerbations consistently improve asthma outcomes. What's shown graphically here is the results of the meta-analysis. And for those of you who are not familiar with this type of display, there's a vertical line down the middle, and anything to the left of that vertical line represents data favoring the use of written asthma action plans from the individual clinical trials noted on the extreme left, versus anything to the right of that center line suggests that usual care did better than use of asthma action plans. And what you can see in this graphic, where they selected those studies that included all the components I mentioned below, that in each case, the outcome was in favor of using a written asthma action plan, and the two larger diamond-shaped bullets represent the aggregates of the two types of studies. So the conclusion clearly was written asthma action plans result in improved asthma outcomes, particularly those that use peak flow, recommendations for use of steroids with exacerbations, and other asthma action points. This study was followed up by a study focusing the same question in children with asthma, as shown on the next slide, by Francine Ducharme and her group up in Quebec in Canada. And they concluded that written asthma action plans also improve outcomes for asthma in children, but that the use of peak flow measurement is not as important as it was in adult. So this systematic review clearly shows that in children, symptom-based asthma plans are superior to peak flow-based asthma plans, but the conclusion that asthma plans are effective in improving asthma outcomes was undisputed.
So when patients leave the office after having the diagnosis of asthma, things that they'll end up going home with, besides the prescription for the medication, and more important necessarily than the prescription for the medication, is the plan of action that they need. You know, so I will draw a picture for the parents of what the lungs look like in the airway. I'll explain in the picture, you know, the different components of asthma, the hyperresponsiveness of the airway, the bronchoconstriction, the swelling, the edema, the mucus, and they'll have a picture of that. And then I will give them a little sort of a chart, which will explain what medicines are, you know, what the name of the medicine is, how much they're supposed to take, how many times a day they're supposed to take it, and specifically what it's targeting. In other words, is it a medication like an inhaled steroid, which is targeting the inflammatory response? And I write all this down because they may not always comprehend it on the first go-round. And then I'll write in a separate column, these are the short-acting medications that we're going to use. This is the dose. This is when you use it. This is the indications to be using it, so that the controller is an everyday medicine to be reused religiously. And then this is your rescue medicine, and you use it for if they're coughing, if you think they're wheezing, so that they know what the medications are for. So they'll always end up going home with this little chart of their controller and their rescue medicines. They'll go home with my picture. Not an artist, but they do go home with a picture so that they understand what they're doing. If they're on any other adjunctive therapies, in other words, children who have nasal allergies, that will also be sort of put into the chart. If we're utilizing nasal steroids because it's a child who has allergic rhinitis, that's also one of their comorbid conditions. So I'll be explaining how those nasal steroids are taking care of the airway in the nose, and the inhaled steroids are taking care of the airways in the lungs. And the airway from the tip of your nose to the base of your lung is one airway. So we need to address it at multiple different levels sometimes. And then once they have that plan, I'll also give them, they usually need notes for school. They usually need asthma action plans for school, which we'll be able to bring to the school so they can give it to their school nurses and their gym teachers, their coaches, especially if they're in organized sports, so that when they're out on the field, anybody who's working with them will sort of know that if the patient is doing coughing or wheezing, that they know what to do, so that when they walk out of the office, they'll at least have a plan. And though they may not have heard it all, at least it's all in writing, and then they always can call. And I think that's really key in our practice, is that parents can get to the physician, you know, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. There's questions can be asked really any time, and especially on a new asthmatic.
The third priority message of the expert panel was that assessing asthma severity is important. The expert panel recommends that once a diagnosis of asthma is made, clinicians should classify asthma severity using the domains of both current impairment and future risk for guiding their decisions in selecting initial therapy. This slide shows how we should assess asthma severity in the impairment domain. So impairment in asthma can be assessed by focusing on three variables: the degree of symptoms that the patient is currently having or has recently had, the impairment in the activity level that the patient is now experiencing or has recently experienced, as well as the current degree of impairment of pulmonary function. The point being, there's not a simple way to assess asthma severity. So those three things need to be focused on. And the good news is this can be done actually very simply nowadays by use of validated patient-centric questionnaires, of which three have been published and well publicized. One is the asthma control test, another is the asthma therapy assessment questionnaire, and one is the asthma control questionnaire. These are all referenced in the guidelines and are readily available online and can be used to be filled in by the patient. Assessing asthma severity requires not only an assessment of the current impairment that we've just described, but also an assessment of the risk. So because patients are at increased risk of those patients who are at increased risk of exacerbations will need more close monitoring and more frequent assessment and likely more frequent medication adjustment. So what are the factors that do appear to increase the risk of future exacerbations or future worsening in lung function? And there are two main areas. One is the degree of current airflow obstruction clearly predicts risk of future bad outcomes, as well as the past history of asthma hospitalizations, emergency room visits, or intensive care room visits. Shown in the two graphics here are studies that look at the relationship between current degree of airflow obstruction and future risks of exacerbations. On the left-hand side, we show data relating the risk of asthma exacerbation in the next 3 years as a current, as a function of current lung airway obstruction measured by FEV1. As you can see, moving from left to right on the horizontal axis, as the FEV1 drops as a percentage of predicted, the risk of asthma exacerbation in the next 3 years increases dramatically. So, for example, if someone has an FEV1 between 60 and 69% of predicted, they have about a 40 to 50% chance of having an asthma exacerbation in the next 3 years. Similar data are shown on the right-hand graphic, which relates the degree of FEV1 abnormality to the risk of having asthma exacerbations in the next 1 year. And here you can see that if someone has an FEV1 of less than 60%, they have a 70% chance of having an asthma exacerbation the next year. So severity can be measured in terms of impairment and risk, and one measurement of risk is the degree of airflow obstruction. The other assessment of risk in assessing asthma severity is the past history. And several studies have looked at this, and I've listed them here. One shows that patients with an emergency room visit for asthma were 2.6 times more likely to need another emergency room visit for asthma in the next 12 months. And another study in children suggested that those children who had three or more emergency room visits for asthma in the prior year were 4.6 times more likely to have an ICU admission for asthma in the next 12 months. These data points underscore the need to assess asthma severity, as it will determine how you treat and how you monitor your patients going forward.
Spirometry is crucial in categorizing asthma severity and initiation of therapy, and crucial in following how well your patient's disease is being treated and how well you are preventing that risk of occurring. But in practical terms, a lot of clinicians don't have spirometry. So they're going to have to take very good histories on symptoms, use of extra medicine, use of reliever medicine. And even that doesn't get you all the patients, doesn't allow you to find all the patients who aren't being treated appropriately. You know, the way I talk to clinicians, the way you should think about it, if a patient has hypertension, they take their blood pressure. If they have diabetes, they check their blood sugar. You've got to be able to check their airways, and spirometry is your only answer. They're inexpensive apparatus that you can have in your office, and even if not, then send them to the local hospital for pulmonary function testing, spirometry, or even use your local asthma specialist to help you do the spirometry, to help you manage your patients.
I'd like to show you your lung functions. This is an objective measurement of how well you're breathing. And if you'll just follow me here, this line represents how well you breathe. And actually, the line is supposed to come up to here. And what this tells us is that you're only breathing at 60% of what we'd expect you to breathe at for someone your age.
Are you serious? This line is me?
That's yours.
So can this be permanent?
Possibly, Jackie, but you're still young yet. We have a lot of time to reverse this, and I'm hopeful that with proper treatment, it won't become permanent, and also we can actually improve you permanently closer to your normal expected values.
Getting a person with any chronic disease where the symptoms, the effect of the disease on them could be intermittent, getting them to take something every day to prevent the symptoms that may not occur very often but could be very serious is very difficult. And the only way to do that is education. Got it. I educate my patients. I draw them pictures of sort of cartoons of what the bronchial tubes look like in someone with asthma. I do spirometry. I show a patient that even though they're not having symptoms, they have asthma. It's there. It's in their bronchial tubes. They have to be taking medicine every day. Get rid of it. So educate, educate, educate.
The fourth priority message of the expert panel suggests that assessing and monitoring asthma control on an ongoing basis is important. They recommend that every patient who has asthma be taught to recognize symptom patterns and or peak flow measurements that indicate an adequate asthma control and the need for additional therapy, and that control be routinely monitored to assess whether the goals of asthma therapy are routinely being met, that is, whether impairment or risk are reduced. The goals of asthma therapy are listed on the next slide, and they are similar to what we mentioned earlier. We need to reduce current impairment and reduce future risk. By reducing impairment, we would like to prevent chronic and troublesome symptoms. We would like to require infrequent use of rescue medications. We would like to have the patient maintain normal or near normal pulmonary function, allow the patient to maintain normal activity levels, including exercise and other physical activity, as well as attendance at work or school, and to meet both the patient's and the family's expectations of and satisfaction with asthma care. In reducing risk, we're trying to prevent future exacerbations, minimize the need for emergency room or hospital visits, prevent progressive loss of lung function, and do so with optimal pharmacotherapy and the least side effects. So by assessing whether we are achieving these goals, we'll know whether we have asthma control. The sad fact also is that with our current approach to asthma management, where we have not been in the habit of routinely assessing asthma control, we really have not been achieving the goals that we set out for ourselves. Here's data from two national and international studies looking at whether we do, in fact, achieve those goals. So there's clearly a big room for improvement in achieving the goals of asthma therapy, and we can only achieve the goals of asthma therapy if we routinely assess control in our patients. If we fail to monitor asthma control, our patients will are at greater risk of having asthma exacerbations. And here's data showing that that really has terrible outcomes in terms of mortality. This is a study that looked at the all-cause mortality in asthmatic patients who have had an ICU admission over a six-year follow-up. So the mortality from any cause for an asthmatic who'd been hospitalized in the ICU for asthma was 10% at 1 year, 14% at 3 years, and 22% at 6 years. Not necessarily saying the death was due to asthma, but these people were at greater risk of dying, and clearly asthma control was a predictor of that. So improving asthma control, keeping patient out of the ICU, is clearly going to improve outcomes.
Quite a lot of patients underestimate, and actually many times the more severe disease they have, the more they underestimate. And we see patients on the opposite side of that coin too. We see patients that overestimate, but we're worried about the ones that underestimate because they're at risk for fatal exacerbations and they're at risk for long-term pulmonary remodeling or permanent lung damage.
The first thing is an understanding of the disease process. The second is a fear that they actually have this disease. So their adherence to the treatment protocol, because they don't want to have asthma. And you'll find in older teenagers that's something they don't want to be labeled with a disease. So getting them over the stigma of having a disease. And then the just technique. One of the biggest problems we have with kids obtaining symptomatic relief, whether it's short-term or long-term control, is actually knowing how to properly use the medication. Because as much as they may see the control and it's working, but once it's working, a lot of parents will say, well, they're doing fine, let's stop their medicine. And that's where a lot of our follow-up visits, one of the reasons we do it is to make sure that they're taking their medicines. But a lot of parents don't want their children on medicine, and they see that they're doing well and suddenly stop it. And then 2-3 weeks later, when their symptoms have recurred after the steroids and the long-term controls have worn off, they're back in the office, and then we have to have that conversation. And it sometimes starts all over again, you know, with the explanation of what the disease is and what we're trying to accomplish. But I think it's always valuable as a general pediatrician, because we have a relationship with the families, and it's very different than an emergency room setting or an urgent care setting. And because of that relationship, I can use that to our advantage. And recognizing that we always have the same best interest, so the parents want the best for their child, and utilizing that for leverage, because I want the best for their child, I'm advocating for them, they're advocating for them. And once you can bridge the gap that we're both in the same place at the same time advocating for the same person, you frequently can get them past those barriers of the disease stigma, that their child's on medicine, that the child doesn't want to take the medicine. And once you get a child who's feeling better, many, many times the child will be able to say, I want to use my medicines because it's making me feel better. And we'll sometimes leverage the child's sense of well-being with the parents. And again, it's utilizing that the child feels better, and that's who we're here for. We're here to try and make the child feel better.
The next goal of the next priority message of the expert panel was underscoring the point we just made, that there's a need to schedule follow-up visits. The expert panel recommends that monitoring and follow-up is essential, and that a stepwise approach to therapy in which the dose and the number of medications, as well as the frequency of administration, are increased as necessary and decreased when possible to achieve and maintain asthma control. The purpose of follow-up visits is to decrease avoidable health care use, decrease the number of urgent care visits or emergency room visits for asthma, as well as increase the patient's quality of life. Essentially, follow-up visits will allow us to assess asthma control and to achieve the goals of asthma care that we mentioned in the earlier slides. The areas of focus in follow-up visits should include areas such as medication adjustment, as we just mentioned, either increasing for the patient who has poorly controlled asthma or attempting to decrease in the stable or well-controlled asthmatics. We should focus on medication adherence. The biggest single reason we do not achieve good asthma control is that patients do not adhere to their medications, and we need to take a more active role in monitoring and enforcing that. Adherence applies not just to medication use, but to recommended environmental control measures, including allergen avoidance, smoking cessation, and other preventive steps such as influenza vaccination. The purpose that for scheduling follow-up visits is that asthma is a very variable disease. Over time, the degree of asthma control fluctuates inherently as a component of the disease. So you cannot assume that the patient who is stable today will remain stable for the rest of the year. Patients, sadly, often fail to recognize poorly controlled asthma, and the follow-up visit assessing asthma control will help the patient realize whether their asthma is controlled or not. We mentioned the low rate of adherence to management recommendations, which include not only prescribed medications, but also environmental control. And by maintaining control through regularly scheduled follow-up visits, we will eliminate most of the cost associated with asthma care, as most of this cost relates to urgent or emergency care, which hopefully will be prevented by more routine assessment of control at follow-up visits. Here is some data that looks at asthma adherence with controller medications. It was taken from a study of the United Healthcare Insurance Company looking at the rates of refill for prescribed asthma medications in a very large group of patients followed over 1 year. What you can see on the vertical axis is the number of refills per year, and on the horizontal axis are the different types of asthma controller medication. Each prescription for a medication should typically last for 1 month, and therefore, if the patient is adherent fully, you would expect approximately 12 refills over a 12-month period. What you can see here is the highest number of refills occurred for montelukast, but sadly that was only 4.3 refills per year, suggesting that for 8 months of the year, patients were not adherent with that medication. The results for the other medications, including the inhaled steroids, such as fluticasone in green, was about 2 refills per year. And for the combination product, fluticasone and salmeterol in a single device, it was about 4 per year. So this data was from 2005, but there's no reason to think it has changed drastically in the interim. But it does underscore the need of us as asthma care providers to encourage adherence amongst our patients, because they will not do it on their own. A recent large international trial known as the GOLD study showed that significant reductions in the rate of severe exacerbations, as well as improvements in quality of life, can be achieved by using guideline-defined asthma control and by adjusting therapy to achieve it. In that study, which was published in 2004, it was shown that by using this stepwise approach to therapy, at the end of 1 year, 30% of patients achieved total control, let's say the absence of any sign or symptom of active asthma, and 60% of patients achieved well-controlled asthma. So this study clearly underscored the benefit of the stepwise approach to medication choice that is outlined in the guidelines.
The problem, if you don't see a patient often, is they don't have, they don't remember or recall more than 4 weeks of information. So if you see a patient every 6-8 months, you're not going to evaluate control because they're not going to remember what happened over that 8 months. So that's why it's important to see the patients more frequently, but also have them bring in 2 weeks of data. It could be sketched out on a piece of paper. Have them keep it I call it a number diary. I had no symptoms, it's a 0. I had a lot of cough, it's a 5. And they keep track of their asthma symptom, cough, chest tightness, shortness of breath, or any type of chest discomfort. And they write it down. And they, or if they wheeze, they write 0 to 5 for those 4 or 5 symptoms. And then how often did they take their short-acting beta agonist in those 2-week period? That's the way I evaluate control. Control is crucial.
So, what did he tell you about your asthma?
He showed me that it was out of control, and I never thought of it that way. I just thought of it as something that I lived with and dealt with. But he showed me my lung tests, and they were pretty bad. And looking and told me that I should never have gone to the emergency room for them.
Well, you've been to the hospital for your asthma too, haven't you?
Yeah, a bunch of times when things got bad. It started when I was a kid. They give me medicines and I get better, so whatever. Now I'm pretty determined not to let that happen anymore. So I have some medicine and I plan to follow, and I promised myself I'd do it. So there's a couple parts. First, he told me when I should call his office if my asthma ever gets worse. I'm not supposed to wait till it really gets bad, so I can't breathe before I call him, so that's good.
That sounds fair. What else?
Well, I got a lot of chores to get my house and stuff in order. Now I already had the rugs pulled up, and I'm a clean freak, so it was easy for me. My boyfriend was another story.
What is the next step for you?
Well, I promised the doctor I'd see him again, so that's a week from now. I'm still not perfect, and he said my goal is to really feel good. He did tell me that my allergies are a big part of this asthma, so there's some other medicines and allergy shots that he may be able to try if this stuff doesn't work.
Last question. Are you happy with your plan?
Let's see if it works before I can really tell you that. Let's say this. I'm really happy that I have a plan. It feels way more secure.
So here we have a patient with pretty intense asthma and who is really limited by her disease. She just lost perspective on what normal is. It's hard to achieve control when a patient can't visualize what control is or can't recognize that they really do need therapy to achieve their treatment goals.
Parents do appreciate the follow-up visits. It's a real healthy reminder as to what are the symptoms they're looking for, you know, touching base with them again to re-educate. It's always valuable to re-educate what our goals are for their individual child, what are the goals of the medication. Parents like to be able to reduce their children's medication, and I fully agree with them. It's nice to get them down to the lower medication. So the follow-up visits allow you to do that, to re-educate and then reassess what you want to do in terms of the medications and the controlling factors. So we do talk a lot about control, and we want them to understand what control is for their child. And it's always a reduction of symptoms so that their children can behave like normal children.
The final priority message of the expert panel was related to control of environmental exposures. The expert panel recommends that patients who have asthma at any level of severity be queried about exposure to inhalant allergens, to tobacco smoke, and other irritants, and be advised of the potential effects of these on the patient's asthma. The panel recommends that allergen avoidance measures be multifaceted, comprehensive, focusing on allergens and irritants to which the patient is sensitive and exposed, and underscores that individual steps alone are generally ineffective. The point being made in this recommendation is that one size does not fit all. It's important to assess the individual patient to determine what their allergic sensitivities are or what irritants they're exposed to, and focus the recommendations for environmental control to that patient based on their particular sensitivities. For example, there were some high-profile studies that looked at the outcomes from issuing dustproof mattress covers to all-comer asthmatics. These were conducted in primary care practices, and not surprisingly, the result was that issuing dustproof mattress covers to all asthmatics had no net effect on asthma outcomes in the population. However, if one were to identify from that those patients those who strictly were dust mite allergic, and in those patients use a comprehensive approach that relied not only on dustproof mattress covers but other measures specific to dust mite avoidance, the measures, so the outcomes may be very different. If we try to assess what role does allergy play in asthma, there are several data points that speak to this. Shown on the next slide is the prevalence of sensitization to different allergens in the population. And what you can see on the horizontal axis is that somewhere up to 20% of patients are sensitized to some allergen, with the top ones being ryegrass pollen, dust mites, ragweed, and Bermuda grass in the United States. However, if you look at the next slide and you subdivide the population into those who have asthma shown in blue versus those who do not have asthma shown in pink, a very different result emerges. Now what you see in the asthmatic population is that the prevalence of sensitization of allergens goes up to about 35%, and at the top of the list now are not the pollen grains but the indoor allergens. So dog allergen, cat allergen, dust mite allergen, those are the ones at the top of the list with a prevalence of about 35%. So these are factors that will be found in the patient's environment, to which the patients are specifically sensitized, and to which environmental control recommendations should be focused. Looking at that in a slightly different way is a study here published by Abraham in 2007, where they looked at a population of patients and tried to assess the likelihood of asthma and the likelihood of having allergies and see how they correlated. They looked at an area of Detroit based on a certain zip code and identified 702 women from that zip code randomly, and did two things. They asked that they drew blood and looked for specific IgE to different allergens, and also asked them whether they ever had a physician diagnosis of asthma. And then they looked at the correlation between the diagnosis of asthma and the risk of and the sensitization to different aeroallergens. Is the relative risk of having asthma based on sensitization to aeroallergens? So if you were allergic to dust mite, the top two allergens, you were about twice as likely as someone not allergic to dust mite of having asthma. If you move to the next two, cat and dog, the risk of having asthma went up to about between 3.6 and 4.8 fold. So being allergic to a cat or dog makes you 4.8 times more likely to have asthma than if you're not allergic. And so on for the other allergens. This then underscores the need to identify what the patient is allergic to and make appropriate recommendations for avoidance of those allergens in the workplace. So the final priority message of the expert panel was to focus on environmental control, to identify and remove exposure to allergens, as well as irritants, including inhaled tobacco smoke. So what I've done in this presentation is to review the six priority messages of the expert panel on asthma and provide some evidence as to why these recommendations are so important, as well as evidence as the efficacy in terms of improved outcomes for asthma by utilizing these priority messages.
I hope that you've acquired some information listening to this program that will enable you to enhance the care of your patients, make them better, have their quality of life improved. A lot of messages, we covered a lot of material. Hopefully there's a number of take-home messages that you've acquired from listening to the program that'll really impact on what you do every day when you see someone with asthma coming through your office. That you'll spend the time and there'll be a little light bulb up here reminding you what this program taught you, and hopefully will influence significantly how you make the life of your asthmatic patients better.